I just wanted to go on with this. So we're set free from the spirit of sin, because we are no longer unspiritual, because we have the spirit of Christ within us. So Romans 7:14 says, we know that the law is spiritual, but I am unspiritual. Now, Paul is not speaking at a time that he does not have the Holy Spirit. He's speaking about how it is to live without that spirit that sets him free. When you say that you're unspiritual, then how could you have the Holy Spirit? So when he says, we know that the law is spiritual, but I am unspiritual, sold as a slave to sin, it's a state of being that is before being regenerated, reborn, and given the Holy Spirit, and no longer a slave to sin. Romans 8:15 solidifies this, because it says, but now there is therefore no condemnation. But you go down, skip down to 15, the Spirit you received does not make you slaves. So hold on a minute. Let's compare Romans 7:14 to Romans 8:15, because this is the same Spirit that Paul received. Romans 7:15, we know the law is spiritual, but I am unspiritual, sold as a slave to sin. Now, is Paul speaking as a person who was unsaved or did not know the law before? Or is he talking about something that after he still struggles with sin? Because if you say after, this is the verse just before it starts going, for I do what I do not want to do. Now compare Romans 8:15. The Spirit, see how it says, we know the law is spiritual, but I am unspiritual. But then Romans 8:15 says, the Spirit you receive does not make you slaves. So we have Romans 7:14, we know that the law is spiritual, but I am unspiritual, sold as a slave to sin. And Romans 8:15, the Spirit you receive does not make you slaves. The Spirit, remember, unspiritual, the Spirit you received, you got a spirit, so you're no longer unspiritual. You just compare the two verses, right? The Spirit you receive does not make you slaves. So here we have Romans 7:14, unspiritual and sold as a slave, and Romans 8:15, the Spirit you received does not make you slaves, so that you live in fear again. And rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship, and by him we cry, Abba, Father. Why is this so important that you get this? Because of thinking and focusing on your sins all the time. Sin has a grip on you as long as you're afraid of sin. So what does lordship do? While you're trying to beat your body into submission, which is a good thing, but the problem is that when you're focusing on yourself, what are you not focusing on? The love of Christ. When you're walking, looking at yourself, what are you going to find? Sin. When you're walking, looking at the Savior who took away the law so that you can worship him, you don't have to be guilty in front of him. Because it says, you're no longer under the spirit of fear. This is Romans 8. You want to compare Romans 8. God has not given us a spirit of fear. Because if you have that spirit of fear, fear drives you to guilt. And shame, and shame and guilt drive you back into your sin again. This is very important for you to understand. This is why I'm so passionate about it, because when I started to live my life not even looking at my sin, but looking more at my Savior, I was praising and rejoicing God for the burden he lifted off of me. And guess what? Sin never came to mind. Never wanted a chocolate donut. Never thought about it. My mind was enraptured by the love of God, the Spirit that made me cry out, Abba, Father. So as long as I walked in the Spirit, I did not gratify the sinful nature. I didn't even think about it. It didn't bother me whatsoever. But now here you are, beating your body into submission, trying to struggle with these stubborn sins, and you're winding up being a slave to them. They're mastering you because you're walking by your flesh. What does walking by your flesh mean? It means you trying to perfect yourself and focusing on your sin in your flesh. And your flesh is worth nothing. When you focus on the Spirit that set you free from sin and death, you're not focused on yourself. The bride eyes, not what? The bride's garment, but her sweet bridegroom's face. See, You don't look at your garment. The bride eyes not her garment, but her sweet bridegroom's face. So when I look at the face of Christ, I'm not looking at my dirty sins. I'm not fearing them. I'm not letting that shame drive me back into habitual sins, whatever they are. And you see, that's how we become set free, by walking in the Spirit. We're eyeing the face of Jesus Christ, who we're not afraid of because He died for us. He loves us. He took the law which oppressed us, which drove us back into habitual sin away, and made us walk in a new way in the Spirit. So when you walk in the Spirit looking at Christ and not your own sins, you're not gratifying the sinful nature, because you're